Jim Clark has always loved airplanes and flying them. He is also an accomplished businessman who has built up a number of successful car dealerships. This success has allowed him to support his passion for aviation. Jim is going to show us his award-winning 1939 Waco EGCH Custom Cabin. This plane has a mirror finish so shiny you can shave in its reflection. Here's Jim.
My name is Jim Clark, and this is my 1939 Waco Custom Cabin. The model designation is EGC8. Waco used an alphabet soup of letters to designate their airplanes, but the E stood for the engine, the G was a closed model, in other words, it's not an open cockpit biplane, and C was the custom series. 8 was designed in 1938. This actually is a 1939 model because they built the EGC8 for 2 or 3 years. This particular airplane was one of 8 that was built for the federal government and served in Garden Island, New York, for the Civil Aeronautics Authority. The CAA eventually became the FAA. This airplane is in the original livery of black and orange. The CAA painted all of their aircraft black, fuselage, and orange wings. I don't think it was so much because it was a color scheme that they liked that much. It was just if a CAA airplane should happen to go down, they would look for those orange wings, and they just won't match anything in nature. This airplane has a gross weight of 3,800 pounds and is powered by a Wright 760 E2, which is 350 horsepower. Originally, the CAA received these airplanes with Jacobs engines on them of lesser horsepower, but the CAA contracted with Wright to provide 8 new engines and 8 new engine mounts, so every one of the aircraft was upgraded to this power plant. It seats 5 people. The original aircraft was required to have Switlik parachute seats. Those are no longer installed in the airplane because I'm not getting out at any time. We have been restoring this airplane since 2007. The previous owner was a Mr. Charlie Hall from Manhattan, Kansas, and I had known him for about 30 years and bought the airplane from him. Prior to that, it was a couple gentlemen out of Kansas City, and we have logs back to the first day that it came out of the factory. It's a great, fun airplane to fly, a very gentle and forgiving airplane. It's probably the easiest landing airplane that I have flown. And it's just a great, gentle, big old airplane. We strive to keep this aircraft as original as possible when we did the restoration. When we got the airplane, it was a metallic green and red, and painted like a newer model Waco. And a lot of your antique airplanes, you'll find they'll try to paint them up in years. I personally think that it's the best choice to try to take them as original as possible. So we took this to the original black and orange. I think it's a pretty airplane in that done. There is one thing we did take artistic license with. On the original order for the federal government, Waco always built their funnel stripe airplanes with 3 colors, 2 major and then a pinstripe. The pinstripe on this airplane was to be gold, like it is on the aircraft now. But the charge to Waco was $7 an airplane for the 3rd stripe. And the purchasing agent for the federal government at that time scratched that off of every order. So the original Wacos were only black and orange. I decided to splurge, spend the $7, and put the 3rd color on in the pinstripe, and I think it helped it quite a bit. So the originals did not have the gold pinstripe. Everything else, the originals also did not have the wheel pants. Everything else is pretty much how it came from the factory. We relocated the oil cooler as a belly-mounted cooler. Originally, it was mounted up underneath the cowl and didn't have the airflow. Now the temperatures stay in the green, and you can go whether it's a hot day or a cool day, and you can go across country with this airplane. The temperatures stay well in the green, and it just makes it a much more usable traveling airplane, because that's what I do with the aircraft. I used to fly for business. Now I fly for fun. I wanted a big SUV, an antique SUV, if you will, that could carry 4 or 5 people and all our stuff and turn heads when we got on the ramp, and this airplane is perfect for that. Here's an interesting item that people ask me about everywhere I fly to. I have a red lens headlight. The landing lights are located under the wing, and they are motorized and come down out of the wing. But I have this red headlight. In the early days of aviation, aircraft navigated from beacon light to beacon light that were spread out across this country, a couple hundred miles apart. They would fly to a beacon light, a rotating beacon, much like on our small airports today. They'd fly to that beacon, take a compass heading, and fly to the next beacon. Because of that, airplanes were flying on a very narrow road in the sky, if you will. And that light is a passing lamp required on government aircraft, so that if you saw that red headlight coming towards you on that road in the sky, you always passed to the right. That's why it's located in the outboard left wing of these aircraft. And that is a passing lamp. And it's one of the few airplanes you'll see that on today. We had a lot of fun with this restoration, researching the insignia that the Civil Aeronautics Authority used on their aircraft. We found old black and white pictures of hangars full of CAA airplanes. But we could find the Smithsonian had helped us a great deal by providing information on what was in the center of the circle. It's a bar and shield with a Wright flyer under an eagle, a bald eagle. Getting a picture of the entire seal was almost impossible. We were able to piece it together with some grainy photographs, and the size and relationship of items, and we ended up painting the seal on. There is no vinyl anywhere used in the seal, and now, my friends at the Smithsonian, I've sent them a high-resolution copy of this, and this is their official 1939 CAA emblem in high resolution. And of course, take note of my $7 gold stripe leading in to the seal. We tried to carry the most original M number we could. When the government had this airplane, they used NC-61. Only the federal government can use two-digit numbers with no suffix. So the previous owner was smart enough to get NC-61, and we used the KS for the suffix. Since it lives in Kansas, that seemed appropriate. The original number, NC-61, was also on the tops of the wings and the bottom of the lower wings. That was very important to us. And a lot of old aircraft, these numbers change as airplanes restore and change and people put their initials on and things. So we were very glad to have the original seal and as close to the original N number as possible. People ask me how this airplane flies, because at 3,800 pounds gross, it's a big, heavy airplane. It's the same gross weight as a Cessna 310 twin-engine aircraft, 6-passenger. So it is a big airplane. The answer is it flies like a joy. The elevators are as light as a feather, and the control inputs are extremely light and balanced, partly because the elevator is a fabric covered. It's tube and fabric covered. But you see a large counterbalance section of the elevator forward of the hinge line. Now, I'm not an aircraft designer. I just know when one flies nice. And this airplane flies just lovely. The horizontal stabilizer is all wood, but it is wood skinned with fabric covering. Much like, well, even the DC-3s used skins for their wings and fabric for their control surfaces. But this is a plywood skinned horizontal stabilizer with the same fabric then glued and covered. The vertical stabilizer and rudder are all fabric covered. One of the only problems we had with the aircraft in restoration was this vertical stabilizer section just forward of the rudder. The fabric over time, it was cotton, had continued to shrink and continued to shrink, and it crushed the support structures inside this tail group. So that had to be completely dismantled, new support structures built and reassembled. When we did that, we also worked very diligently on fitting the rudder into the fuselage and the flow of that line that they just simply wouldn't do at the factory on an airplane that was good enough for the government. I have something to show you up here now that you'll probably find really interesting. This aircraft is a two-door. Only the government-manufactured WACOs were two doors. The normal entry door is on the pilot side. They required a second door so that people could get out of the aircraft in case of emergency. Remember, I mentioned that this was equipped with Switlik parachute seats. So when you sat down in a seat and strapped on, you were wearing a parachute. In addition to the two doors, there is a lever in this door, an emergency do not touch lever. If you are inside the aircraft with the door secured and you turn that lever, the doors will separate at the front and leave the aircraft in flight. You then fall out with your parachute. Those levers are still functional. My only requirement is that if you pull the lever, you follow the door out.
That's good.
A feature of this WACO model that I feel is quite pilot friendly are the speed brakes. Now they're referred to as split flaps in the owner's manual. When you deploy these flaps, which are vacuum actuated, they deploy to one position, which now you can understand why the rear door is cut at this funny angle. It's so that if you leave them down, they don't break the glass out of the door when you open the door. These split flaps split away from the upper surface of the wing. And in my experience with the aircraft, they do not increase lift. You would expect most flaps to do that. There is one position of these flaps, and that's fully deployed. The approach numbers on this aircraft is 100 mile an hour downwind, 90 on base, and do not go under 80 miles per hour until there is runway under your tires. Deploying these speed brakes will take a high, fast approach, and on final, you'll be adding power. That's the only way I can describe these, because they literally will make you sit forward in the seat when they deploy. They slow the aircraft down that effectively. Now, the benefit of that, when your tires touch, you don't have to worry about bouncing a 3,000-pound airplane with speed brakes deployed. You are on the ground. Also, it makes shorter fields very capable in this aircraft. One concern that I'm addressing is when I go into Blakesburg. I have never had to try to execute a go-around after the speed brakes are deployed. So we're going to practice that every time before I head to Blakesburg, because if they wave me off with the red flag, I think it's going to take every bit of that 350 horsepower to get this airplane back in a flying configuration and let those speed brakes stow. Every WACO built was a biplane, but in fact, their custom cabin series were sesquiplanes, and that means the lower wing was half the surface area of the upper wing. There's been debate as to why this was done that way. I personally believe that they had approved structures for wings in their cabin series aircraft, and it required this strut assembly. Replacing flying wires on the biplane, they used these fixed struts. The only adjustment point in these struts is in the rear strut of the lower wing on the custom cabin. And you can set the wash so that you can adjust them so the airplane will fly level and not a bank, or will not be wing heavy. If WACO were to change and go to a monoplane, a single wing, they would have had to recertify their entire attachment structures. But that would have been too much money. So they went with a smaller, lower wing, thereby giving them the bridge work to support a very large upper wing. And yes, this is a lifting surface, and yes, it contributes to the flight, but not as much as on the Wacos that have the same length upper and lower wings. But of course, according to Waco, real airplanes had round engines and two wings. Maybe that's why Waco's not around any longer. When this aircraft was designed in 1938, Waco was certainly feeling a changing aviation industry. People were starting to show interest in tricycle gear airplanes. The tail wheel scared people. They were hard to handle. What do we do? Waco responded by widening the gear on their custom cabin series after 1936 to a full 9 feet wide to give the ground handling characteristics that people wanted. Then in the Dash 8 model, they extended the aircraft another foot. It's the longest custom cabin. Move the tail wheel back as far as possible, all for ground handling. They even went as far as moving the main gear back on this cabin aircraft, which shifted the center of gravity forward in relation to the gear, so they put a nose wheel on these beautiful airplanes. You know, I own 4 airplanes and not a single one has a training wheel. Do not be afraid of tail wheel airplanes.
They're the best airplanes in the world.
What makes this old Waco such a great airplane to fly is this engine. It's a Wright Whirlwind, 760 cubic inch, 7 cylinders. Now do the math, that's 108 cubic inches per cylinder. And this is a model E-2, which is a supercharged, internally supercharged engine. So we produce 350 horsepower at 2,400 RPM, which is only used for 1 minute during climb, initial takeoff and initial climb. Then we go to a climb setting of 2,200 RPM and 29 inches manifold pressure, which gives us the 320 horsepower to climb out. When you go to cruise settings, you'll be cruising at 1,950 to 2,000 RPM and 24 inches of manifold pressure, and will burn about 20 gallons per hour. Not for the faint of heart, because that's only going to get us about 130 miles per hour. This engine was used a lot by the military and of course by everyone. In the M3N Navy trainers, they used a 760-8, which was the non-supercharged version of this engine. I have that engine on a 1929 Waco CSO open cockpit biplane. So that's my really old airplane. This was built almost 10 years later, so this is just, everything's up to date in Kansas City with this airplane. The engine is very reliable and very smooth. Everyone's very familiar with the Wright 985s, and then they would start double stacking rows into 1340 and huge engines they came out with. But the Wright 760 is just a surprisingly smooth engine, very predictable, very reliable. It is also very known for hydraulic lock. And if you have flown a radial engine, you know what I'm talking about. But what happens with a radial engine? There is no crankcase for the oil. The oil is in an oil tank. A pump pumps the oil through the engine, and then a scavenge pump takes the oil back up to the tank. Oil remaining inside the case is going to find its way down into this lower cylinder right here. If you hit that starter with that cylinder full of oil, you will bend a rod and break a cylinder. It will happen. So we have to be very careful to either, one, not allow oil to accumulate in this cylinder, or to make sure we pull the propeller through by hand, we count 14 blades or 7 complete revolutions. One pull across would be 1 blade. 14 blades, 7 complete revolutions. So every cylinder goes through its entire intake and exhaust phase. That can still give you problems. It can still hydraulic lock. We've installed an oil shutoff valve on this aircraft to try to avoid that. So anytime we are sitting, whether it's at an air show for an hour or 15 minutes, or it's weeks at a time, we shut the oil off from the tank to the engine so that none can seep past the pump impellers and fill these bottom jugs with oil. This box here is the fresh air induction for the carburetor, which is located aft and low under the engine. Radial engines historically run at lower RPMs. If you're flying anything from a Pacer to a 172 or 182, you're seeing 2,300 RPM as a cruise quite often. We cruise this airplane at 1,950 RPM. Bigger engines, lower compression, plenty of torque because of the cubic inches, and it swings a large paddle at a high pitch, low RPM through the sky and has a different sound. And once you've heard the radial engine sound, you'll identify it. When you're working the throttle on a radial engine, the key word is smooth. From stop to stop, you want to take a minimum of 2, better 3 seconds. 1001, 1002, 1003. You do not want to be fast grabbing a throttle on a radial engine. You can cause backfires, you can cause, the engines just weren't designed for that. And I think that's one of the key things. I have flown Starduster, the Huskies, the Cubs, an awful lot of flat engines. I've flown the Saratogas and I've 310s and all the 400 series Cessnas. And the key, I think, between a flat engine and the radial engine is just plan to be friends with the engine and don't expect it to go from zero to full RPM in 1 second. They're not designed to do that. If you think ahead of the engine and just be gracious with it, these old power plants will last a long, long time. One thing we had to do on the restoration of this aircraft was to determine where to get this engine overhauled. And if you talk about the lost arts, radial engine overhaul seems to be fitting right into that description. There's one gentleman in the United States that I would trust with a supercharged Wright aircraft engine. His name is Mike Connor. Mike Connor Radial Engines in Georgia. It is a one-man shop. He has more information, and we have called Mike numerous times for how-tos on little things. I am sure hoping he is training someone because we need men like Mike, because he completely overhauled this engine, put on 2 new cylinders because unbeknownst to us, 2 of the cylinders were wrong. They were from the larger Wright engine, used different spark plugs, same displacement, same size, but they were not correct for this engine. As I understand it, Mike's grandfather bought all of the parts from Wright aircraft engines when they went out of business. So when Mike called me and said, you need 2 other cylinders, I said, well, Mike, where will we find those? He says, well, I have them new on the shelf. Mike Connor in Georgia, if you're flying a Wright, you need to get to know Mike Connor. But the Wright 760E2, it's a great power plant match to this aircraft. And of course, this airplane wouldn't go anywhere without a propeller. And this is the famous Hamilton Standard 2B20 propeller used on innumerable aircraft. Now, this is a constant speed propeller, and it has a forward-mounted governor. So this propeller uses oil pressure to change the pitch of the blades. When we got the aircraft, it was a 2-speed, same propeller, but was considered a 2-speed propeller. And we had the propeller shop in Oklahoma City modernize it to a full constant speed propeller because it originally came with us with the leather seals and earlier technology structure. And there is enough demand, primarily from the duster and sprayer industry that used so many radial engines for so many years. They're moving to turboprop. But they had to find ways to modernize these propellers. So So the insides of this propeller are very modern. We don't use oil-soaked leather seal elements anymore. We use the rubber seals, and it's a full constant speed propeller. And I adjust it from in the cockpit. That's why I can take off and get 2,400 RPM by flattening these propeller blades and spinning it fast. And when I get to cruise, I can increase the pitch of the blades, reducing the RPM down to the 1,950 to 2,000 RPM, but still taking a good bite of air. My 760-8 on my CSO is a fixed pitch propeller on my 10-year-old biplane, which is basically the same propeller, but just in a fixed pitch configuration. Most Wacos were pretty much custom built. They build them one at a time, except for this group for the government. And they used other manufacturers' items that were available. As an example, these coach lights are from a 1937 Buick, and that's what Waco used. Whatever was available. Once you get inside, this is a touch that was original. The Waco cabins that were built for the federal government had flare tubes. Now this was a tube box sat aft of the passenger compartment, was exposed to the in the side of the fuselage. And if, for example, you were flying on a dark and lonely night and there were no lights where you were going to land, you would, for emergency use only, open that, activate your flares, and you could launch a burning magnesium flare with an explosive from your dope-covered fabric airplane. I question the intelligence behind that, and I think the Forest Service today would be a little upset if you sent your burning flares into the hinterland so you could see the ground. But we did leave the control panel in, and we did mock the flares on the airplane. We removed the original flare box. The panel and everything is pretty straightforward. The giant throttle knob, our propeller RPM control, and our mixture control. We have all of the interior panels and placards we've had redone for this airplane to match the original placarding. All the original placards were in the aircraft, but they corroded and just didn't match the appearance we were looking for. We've got our transponder and our comm radio and the original directional gyro that still works. We replaced the compass. Originally it had the compass that you looked at the side of the compass and it rotated on a horizontal plane. The panel was painted in burled walnut wood grain, but that is a metal panel that has been painted burled walnut. That's how they were done from the factory. If you look at automobiles from the 30s, many had metal dashes that were painted to look like wood. It's not like any assortment of gauges that you'd be used to in a modern airplane, and that takes a little getting used to. Everything else is original. The oil temperature gauge is not original, but everything else is original. The placarding we had all redone because of corrosion. It holds 47 gallons per side. Both tanks feed together. I love the gas gauge. The gasoline gauge is a 1938 Chevrolet. Since there's two tanks, you switch your switch to read the amount of fuel in each tank. But it's pretty straightforward. This aircraft has a throwover yoke in the center section. So you can just pull the pin and hand the yoke to the co-pilot. It does make for a nice system because the co-pilot's knees are in open space. And we have used some modern avionics in some of the instrument holes. For example, our communications radio is this Becker that's mounted here, and our transponder is mounted here. This gives us all the communication capability. And of course, we kept the old coffee grinder radio. This is the original VHF comm that was in the airplane. actually had an antenna that you could trail out behind the aircraft to use. Since this was in this position, we decided to use this position a little creatively and used it. We glued the old original radio face onto a removable cover. So the moving map with NEXRAD weather radar and all of our information is now available. And when we park it at air shows, we put the old original coffee grinder radio. They call it a coffee grinder because that's how you work the radio. Everything else has been done to just try to maintain its original appearance. The flying qualities of this airplane can be described as pleasant. Control movement, even the weight of the elevator. I've had a Cessna 182, and if you're sitting on the ground in the 182, you have to pull your yoke back to raise the elevator. This aircraft is balanced just fingertip touch, which makes it just a joy to fly. No surprises with this airplane. And when you consider this was built in a time when there was no CAD and computer-aided engineering programs, they really put together an airplane that flies very well and is very comfortable. You can establish a bank in this aircraft and it will just track it around like it's on a rail. The airplane has a locking tail wheel. So at takeoff, you lock the tail wheel, although the tail stays on the ground a very short time. There is enough power in this engine. Takeoff process would be to full throttle, push forward on the yoke to raise the tail so you can see the runway, and the tail will come up very quickly. Then, within moments, you're at a speed that will support the rudder and you'll roll down on your main gears. At about 65, you apply a little bit of back pressure and you'll be flying. And it's just as, I really compare this to my Piper Cub. No surprises, it does what you expect it to do. And much like my Cub has a speed range that envelops about 30 miles an hour total, same way here, you cruise at 130 and you better be in the pattern no slower than about 90 and cross the fence, you stay above 80. Landing with the speed brakes down, you pretty much just position the aircraft and the aircraft will do a wheel landing, which means the main gear will touch before the tail wheel touches. That's my preferred landing anyway. You keep good visibility over the nose because you can't taxiing around, you can't see anything in front of this airplane, which is why it's great to have windows that roll down, because all you do is stick your head out and you can see what's in front of you. Great airplane.
I grew up in Lawrence, Kansas, and had a very active local airport there. And my best friend, and his name, believe it or not, was John Earhart, and his dad managed the airfield. So, you know, we went to church together and everything. And growing up, John and I just ended up playing out at the airport. And I remember my first ride in an American Eagle biplane, which would have been about probably a 1924. 25 aircraft, I believe, open cockpit, and I probably was about, you know, 9. And that was a pretty amazing experience for me. I ended up getting my first flight training at that field. I traded an old pickup truck for flying lessons when I was 16 and 17 years old. And I soloed there, and I was just around it all the time. John now has a big spray operation out in Dodge City, Kansas. We're still friends, and I had planned to go fly for the Marine Corps, but Vietnam was scaling down and that didn't work out, so
Had to find a job where I could afford to have gas and fly airplanes, so I chose the automobile business and used the airplanes initially traveling to auto auctions all around the Midwest and around the country. I was usually flying 3 days a week. Now that we do all that on the internet, I'm able to concentrate on my love of antique airplanes. And through our EAA chapter and as chairman of the National Biplane Fly-In, which is held the first weekend of June in Junction City, Kansas, at Freeman Field, I'm able to devote the time and spend the time to really learn what these great old airplanes are about. I've been blessed. I have about 5,000 hours flying, about 800 hours in tailwheel aircraft of different types. I've flown experimentals and Stardusters and the Woody Pusher. I had a Woody Pusher airplane that was an absolute widowmaker. It would just kill you. So do not think that small light airplanes are easier than a big old cabin Waco. Cabin Waco, if you give me somebody that can fly a Cessna 150 or I should say a 140, a tailwheel airplane, and I can transition them in that cabin Waco in just a couple hours, but that Woody Pusher was a murderous airplane. And I did fine. I never had a problem with it, but sold the airplane. And in fact, its first incident was with the professional pilot taking it to Arizona for its new owner. He put it up on its nose. But it's been great. It's great to be around Junction City, Kansas, and antique airplanes with Raven Arrow here, to where we can, we can call Marvin and say, Marvin, it's doing this, and I don't know what, and they can keep us in the air. If you're considering an antique airplane, it's important to make those connections, but there is nothing better. Why do we fly? In a time in history where you can fly, why aren't you flying? People worked for 4,000 years to try to get us in the air, and now we can. And with the new light sport license, oh my goodness, what an amazing opportunity to fly in an aircraft with you and someone else, where a license is obtainable within a few weeks to a month. You can obtain a light sport license and experience what very few people. And I'm not talking about climbing into a big silver tube and looking out a pie plate size window from 35,000 feet. Until you've crushed the clover in a light airplane, you don't really know what flying is. I've been very involved with the Young Eagles program with the Experimental Aircraft Association. I've given over 150 kids, age 8 to 17 years old, airplane rides, their first airplane rides. I mean, that's what did it for me. And if you're a pilot out there and you're not doing that, then shame on you. Someone did it for you. And sharing this amazing experience is a worthwhile venue. So I encourage you to do that first. Talk to people that are in aviation, in all aspects of aviation. I have very good friends that fly 90 mile an hour biplanes on the weekend and 500 mile an hour 767s for a job. It's the joy of that experience can be shared, and light airplanes are the way to do it. Antique light airplanes are even better. It is really easier for a pilot to get into antique aviation than they might consider. First of all, there's a lot of tax laws that encourage ownership of antique, whether they be cars or aircraft. Property tax isn't charged on antique airplanes in a number of states, so you can own the airplane without continuously renting it from the government, and that's a plus. And if you would consider that my first foray, if you will, into older airplanes was with a Piper Tri-Pacer, the famous milk stool. I bought one for my daughter to learn to fly because I discovered you could buy the nicest Tri-Pacer on the market for about $25,000. There, you can't buy a midline bass boat for $25,000. So I purchased this little tri-pacer, and I had, at that time, I had a Cessna 421, an 8-passenger turbocharged geared engine, high altitude, pressurized aircraft. It basically had the same operating expenses as the USS Missouri that I was flying for business. And I bought this tri-pacer for my daughter, you know, and then I started flying it. And it returned me to the joy of flying a little airplane. And so don't think that it takes hundreds of thousands of dollars to get into this sport. And there is nothing like taking your own airplane to a weekend fly-in nearby and sitting down under the wing in a lawn chair and sharing, there I was at 10,000 feet stories with your buddies. There's just absolutely nothing like it. And I'd encourage people to try tailwheel aircraft also. There is a tremendous tailwheel myth, and it is perpetuated by tailwheel pilots that will assure you that you have to be godlike to fly a tailwheel aircraft. I do, but I am. And stop that. Think about it. Every flyer that won the first two big ones, World War I and World War II, learned in a tailwheel aircraft. The Piper Cub is a tailwheel airplane, and pilots soloed in that airplane in 3.5 hours of instruction. So don't be afraid of tailwheel airplanes. There are so many available in the teens and nice ones in the 20s that you can get into flying. One great thing about aviation is you're going to find a lot of clubs that you can join. There is a short wing Piper Club that involves all the short wing Pipers, Tri-Pacer, Pacer, Vagabond, and those. A great organization is the EAA, the Experimental Aircraft Association. And there are local chapters all over the country. We have a chapter here in Junction City, Kansas. In fact, we as a local chapter sponsor the National Biplane Fly-In because that's what we like to do. But if you're interested in aviation, get on the web, go to eaa.org, and look for a local chapter. You will be welcomed. And if you want an airplane ride, just show up at an EAA meeting. People will be hustling to give you a ride in an airplane, and you don't have to be a pilot to join. Just simply love the thought of aviation, new and old, light or heavy, it doesn't matter. Look up a local EAA chapter and get involved. It sure beats playing Mario Kart. If you love to think about aviation, if you love to see airplanes, be around airplanes, even hear some pilot stories or be around other pilots, or you're thinking about being a pilot, you need to come to the National Biplane Fly-In in Junction City, Kansas. It's on the first weekend of June. EAA Chapter 1364 has taken up the helm to run that operation, and biplanes from all over the country converge on a little grass strip airport in Junction City, Kansas, first weekend of June every year. You will see aircraft that don't exist in museums. The difference is you'll hear them. You'll smell the fuel being burned. You'll see them taking off and landing. You can get a ride in one. It is a historic event and an experience that's not to be missed, especially if you have a family and want to show them a great time on a beautiful weekend in June in Kansas. Be at the National Biplane Fly-In the first weekend of June. You're going to love it, and we'll love to see you there. The single greatest thing about aviation, whether it's light sport, aerobatics, antique, whatever aviation interest you may have, or just being around airplanes, the best thing is the people. When you have an opportunity to find people that share your passion, that's the best thing in the world, and you will make friends for life. Get involved with aviation. Get a light sport license. Just go out and get involved with the local EAA chapter. The people you meet will be the people you enjoy most to be around. Look forward to seeing you at the next fly-in. Be sure to attend the National Biplane Fly-In in Junction City on the first weekend of June. And get out and enjoy aviation.